Father, we thank you and we praise you for this another opportunity to share your word. As always, we're leaning totally upon you to open up our understanding. Make us receptive to your voice. Let your people see and hear you in spirit. To where go forth with power, that the one who don't know you will come to know you. Let it go forth with conviction, that the one who is backslidden will come and be restored. Let it go forth in exhortation, that the one who is downtrodden and bewildered will be encouraged to run on and see what the end is going to be. And Father, we'll be so careful to give your name all the praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We do give honor to God this morning. Give honor to our officers. Give honor to our mothers. We give honor to our First Lady. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise for our youth and young people today. Give a gift in the name of God. Thank God for our minister of music, those leaders and our musicians who serve. We know God is truly good and has been and continues to be good to us. Amen. Amen. You have your Bibles and you return to two passages of Scripture this morning. One is found in the book of Malachi, the second chapter. Put your finger there and flip over to Romans chapter 1. Malachi chapter 2 is our Old Testament scripture. And Romans chapter 1 is our New Testament scripture. Amen. Amen. You have it if you would stand in honor of God's word. Malachi chapter 2, verse 11, Romans chapter 1, verse 28. Malachi chapter 2, verse 11, Romans chapter 1, verse 28. Malachi chapter 2, verse 11 reads in this manner, Judah hath dealt treacherously, and an abomination is committed in Israel and in Jerusalem. For Judah hath profaned the holiness of the Lord which he loved, and hath married the daughter of a strange god. The Lord will cut off the man that doeth this, the master and the scholar out of the tabernacles of Jacob, and him that offer an offering unto the Lord of hosts. Romans chapter 1, verse 28. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. You may be seated in the presence of God. Romans 1:28 says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. We want to speak from the subject this morning. Don't be trumped by what's happening. Don't be trumped by what's happening.
All right. All
right.
Don't be trumped
Amen.
By what's happening. If you've been following the media, like many, you may feel like you're in a state of mourning. Many in our nation who have been attacked for their ethnicity, attacked for their religion, attacked because of their race, attacked because of their disability, all now have to swear allegiance to a president who belittled them. And if I can be real this morning, we can just take off the collar and just be real this morning, it just doesn't feel good. I've been wondering all week as I watched as President Obama spoke, as I watched as Secretary Clinton spoke, as I watched the many protests that have been launched, I've been wondering how many who were offended, how many who were outdone and undermined, how many who were outmaneuvered by this man who displayed such strange behavior will be able to turn the other cheek in obedience because the powers that be are ordained by God. I mean, clearly, I don't know about you, but for me, it's going to take some time to heal. The pain of loss that's causing people to pour into the streets in protest is not the same that we've seen in the past. Because with this loss, with this particular loss, it comes a sense of fear, a sense of anger, a sense of anxiety, a sense of trepidation over what will happen in the upcoming months and the years to come. And all of these emotions have been provoked by what I call the Trump factor. And so in our nation, where nonviolent passive protest was the norm, we are now seeing what happens when a candidate gives license to violence and extremism. And so the question now becomes, was God in control of this election's outcome? And the answer is, of course he was. Can I tell you that God is always in control? God is in control of all things. That means during the primary, God was in control. During the conventions, God was in control. During the campaigning and the mudslinging, guess what? God was in control. And yes, even on this past Tuesday, God was in control. And so the problem is that in our sorrow, what we fail to recognize is that God has a sovereign will and God has a permissive will. Say that again. God has a sovereign will. Because he's God, his sovereign will is preordained and it provides us with all that he has promised. In other words, in God's sovereignty, he still promised us that we're going to have everlasting life. In his sovereignty, he promised that we could still cast all our cares upon him because he's God and he cares for us. But not only is he God and he's a sovereign God, but how many know God has a permissive will, and his permissive will allows things to happen. His permissive will allows things to happen for our good. His permissive will allows things to happen for our detriment. His permissive will allows us to experience hard lessons through chastisement. Oh, you do know that every now and again, the Lord himself has to show up and chastise us. Why? Because we're not always good. We're not always obedient. And when we don't do his will, when we don't submit to his will or his way, I just believe the Lord has to put something on us that we can't look and blame another man. We can't look and blame another system, but we have to know and acknowledge that it is God who is doing the chastisement. And so those of us who study the word of God will readily recognize the difference between God's sovereignty and God's permissive will. And if you do, then you will know that as a nation, we said it this morning in Sunday school, and I said it because it's true, we just may be well entering a season of separation from God. Oh, yes, yes, this is tough this morning. Why? And I say all this because I just believe in my spirit. God is displeased with our nation. When we look at America for a moment. America, the land of the free. America, the home of the brave. America, the country who boasts allegiance that we are one nation under God. America, the one that is founded on religious beliefs centered in Christianity. In America, when we put in God, we trust on our money. In America, where we swear our elected officials with their hand on the word of God. In America, right here in this ground, we have witnessed in this past year foolery in a bid to gain the White House. In America, we have witnessed in the past year alleged corruption in the State House. In America, in the past year, we have witnessed same-sex marriage in the courthouse. In America, we see metal detectors and police security in the schoolhouse. And that's not even talking about unemployment. We haven't talked about gang violence. We haven't talked about the thugging and bugging. We haven't talked about the drug issue. We haven't talked about the police brutality, the absentee parents, the illiteracy of our youth. And let me put a pin right here. It's inexcusable for any person not to get an education in this day and age, but that's an issue that we have not addressed. And while we don't admit it, I just believe in my spirit that all of this is happening because there's a whole lot of compromise, a whole lot of backbiting, a whole lot of backsliding, a whole lot of negativity, mediocrity, and division and carnality in the church house. You do know that in times like these, God is not calling on politicians, but he's calling on the church. Where is the church at today when all this is going on? And so I said this to say that I just believe God is displeased with America. And we don't have to think very hard or come up with many reasons why God may be displeased with this nation, especially when we consider the text today that we have chosen. Now, we have heard what the political pundits had to say. We have heard what history has to say. We have heard what the media has to say. But I think it's time we have to hear what the Word of God says. And when I look here in chapter 1 of Romans, verse number 29 says, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, and whisperers. Then we go down to verse 30, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud boasters, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, unnatural affection, implacable and unmerciful. The question is, we need to understand that God has become displeased with us because we are allowing any and everything to transpire in our midst. Here in the text, the Apostle Paul lists some of the sins that surface from the contemptible attitude. In other words, we have gotten so far away from God until we just start coming up with all kind of stuff. And when you start submitting and sweeping stuff under the rug and accepting things and accepting certain behaviors because we love individuals. Let me tell you something. Tina Turner said it best. What's love got to do with it? Let me tell you, I'd rather have somebody that's living upright and doing the right thing. I can love you, but honey, I can't love you and have you in my space if you're not living according to the will of God. And so when we look at this stuff here that Paul lists here in Romans, if these things are sin that angers God, then surely the wrath of God is justified. When we can look and we can, all this stuff ought to sound familiar to us. When I look at this, I know that we see a whole lot of folk being unrighteous. I know we see a whole lot of fornication and wickedness. I know we see a whole lot of envy and debate. I know we see a whole lot of haters of God. Nobody wants to know what God has to say. Nobody wants to acknowledge God. We got a whole lot of covenant breakers. folk without natural affection. Let me put a pin right here. On last week, you know, we're in the season of selecting your benefits for the upcoming week, or the upcoming year, rather. And so this year, for whatever reason, the county wanted to have all kinds of documentation to prove that you are married and prove that your children are your children. And so we looked high and low, and we found the kids' birth certificates. We had utility bills, but I couldn't find my marriage license. So I got in the car, and I went downtown to the courthouse and to get a copy of the marriage license. And as I stood in the line, you know, we're making pleasantries with folk, and there were people there that were there applying for marriage license. And I was watching men and women swear in and swear that what they said was true. But I couldn't help notice it was just something different about the couple that was in front of the lady that was in front of me. And it wasn't until they turned around that I saw it was two women. Unnatural affection. How dare we sit and cast out everything that God stood for when we declared that we were going to be a saved country, a new country, and the revolution. We pledged allegiance to God. We pledged allegiance to His Word. But now we have folk who don't even think about God when they're doing what they're doing. And so I hear folks saying, don't put this on me. I didn't do this. I didn't think like this. I didn't want the divisiveness and the disunity and the selection to cause. But the question is, do you really feel that way? For the recent weeks, we heard a whole lot of husbands and wives arguing. We heard a whole lot of children fighting in school about candidates they couldn't even vote for. Do we really care? We had neighbors pitting neighbors against one another, yard signs being pulled up, and folks' houses being in churches even being graffitied on and burned down. We had a whole lot of stuff going on. We had two candidates slinging mud and dung, if you will, to muster up the whole healthy somebody. I'm just calling it like this. We had a whole lot of mess going on. And I know you thought like I thought. Listen, I thought for a moment in the last 2 decades, because I've only been able to vote and be a part of an election since the early 90s, and in the past 2 decades, we have seen the slow and steady deterioration of the fabric of our being. I'm not just talking about in political campaigns, but I'm talking about society as a whole. We are in a moral decline, and it's not until we come up morally that we can do anything about what else we're seeing. And the outcome of this election has affirmed one thing, and that is, as a nation, we are moving further and further away from God. And so as I studied the text last night, I was struck by the parallel between our present circumstances and the situation that Judah faced here in Malachi, the second chapter. Look at Judah, how it was. And like us, Judah was surrounded by sin. The Apostle Paul said, I want to do right. I want to do the right thing. But every time I look around, evil is present on every hand. And all you have to do, listen, everywhere you turn, there's some evil. Everywhere you turn, there's immorality. And I've looked at this, and I've looked at this text here in Malachi. Even so, God expected Judah to remain faithful to Him. And I just come back here today to tell the church, no matter what you see going on, no matter what is going on in the world, God still expects Christians to be faithful to Him. God still expects Christians, let me bring it closer to home, He expects the church, hallelujah, to live a certain life. He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, God says, then I'll hear you. I forgive you, and I'll heal. And so when we look at the scripture here in Malachi, scripture says that Judah dealt treacherously with God, committing abominations that profane God's holiness. I mean, isn't that just what we saw happen to America during this election season? Even the evangelical arm of our nation. I don't know about you, but I was saved by a certain preacher right here in this area who dealt treacherously with God and committed an abomination in America that profaned the holiness of the Lord it claims to love. In other words, everything that we see be something sacred about this desk. Amen. That I am so particular, even with the women in ministry issue and all that kind of thing. Let me tell you something. You've got to be careful who you allow to use the pulpit to say anything. And we had folks who opened up their pulpit in the name of money, in the name of popularity. And you got to listen, when you begin to play with God like that, you got to know that God is the player. They even broke bread together while they determined to stand on their common ground and ignore the rest. And so what did Judah do to bring wrath of God down on their nation? Well, it's there in the text. Their leaders morphed into a familiar role of contempt of God's law. They allowed themselves to become watered down by the ungodly influence around them. And let me just say this. We got to stop expecting the world to set the standard for us. We set the standard for everybody else to live by. That's why it doesn't matter what everybody else is doing. It doesn't matter what everybody else is saying. What does the Word of God say? What does God say about certain issues? And I say it all the time that yes, we have to live in the world. Yes, we have to get along with people in the world. But as Christians, our feet can be on the ground, but our hearts got to be on heavenly things. In other words, that heaven, that new Jerusalem that we talked about in Sunday school, we can experience that right now in the spirit. Don't be drunk by what you're seeing. Oh, yes. And so as soon as Judah found themselves profaning God's name with their contemplatable attitudes, they put it simply, they were steering their people away from God. It's right here in Malachi, the second chapter. I mean, isn't that just what we saw happen over these many months of this bitter campaign? I don't know about you there, but as disappointed as I am with the outcome of the election, I sure am glad that we don't have to hear no more debates. We don't have to hear no more of those crazy commercials. We don't have to worry about all that other foolishness that we saw and heard. Think about all this. One candidate with his contemptible attitude provoked half of a nation to chant his shameful, despicable, and distasteful position toward race, toward religion, and even toward God. And if the truth be told, we as a nation were trumped by a master manipulator who was able to boast and brag about what he did. He boasted and bragged that he could commit murder without fear of reprisal. I can go out into the middle of the city and shoot up a whole bunch of folks. Listen, you, who talks like that? We were trumped. We were trumped by the one who bragged that because he was a star, he could rope women and not pay income tax. And then had the audacity to teach his followers to chant, "Lock her up," with all that what he was doing. And so when I look at what happened in Judah and I look at America in the text, when Judah strayed this far from God, how many know God had to send a prophet by the name of Malachi to deliver a message to the wayward nation? And so all I'm trying to tell you is that we got to open up our ears, open up our eyes, open up our heart, because I believe the Lord is about to send a messenger to speak to this situation. Here in the text in Malachi, the second chapter, in fact, he sent Malachi to deliver his message, and the name Malachi even means messenger. And so I don't know about you, but you better start looking for Malachi to rise up in our midst. Oh yes, Malachi's burden was to carry God's message of retribution to a lost generation for breaking the covenant on which they once stood. I believe that something's about to happen that's going to remind America that yes, we declare we're one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Why? Because we don't see that happening now. Malachi had to come and bring the message that we had to, that we once stood on allowing sin to rule our lives. Listen, there's no room for sin. You can't be in two places at one time. You can't serve two masters at one time. You gotta make up your mind. What side are you gonna be on? You can't straddle the fence. You can't have one foot in the world and another foot in the the word of God. You gotta make a choice and make a decision who you are gonna live for. And so Malachi's message was clear. God had given up on Judah. Judah would suffer through 400 years of silence until Christ came. And so the question I want to ask this morning is, could that be what is about to happen to us? Have we been sucked into sin to the point of no return? Can't even the evangelicals, now I'm not talking about those preachers that submitted to what they were hearing and seeing, but I'm talking about the church. Can the church of our nation be willing to turn a deaf ear to the maniac and the rantings of a man whose mannerism and his mouth is certainly out of control? Let me tell you something. You don't know, and I can just stop right here. This is a public, a service announcement. That's why we kept encouraging you to vote. That's why we kept encouraging you to exercise. Let me tell you, because, and let me tell you, those who did vote, you just as well had voted. And so how does the church reconcile the support of such an exhibition of sin? And I don't know about you, but I thought it would have never happened. I said it a million times, I just don't think that this nation would allow something like that to take place. But guess what? It happened. It did. 55 million Americans, many of them professed Christians, wore their contemptible attitude like a badge of honor. And like Judah, they followed the path of sin, committing abominations that profane God's design for a nation who, despite its apostasy, still has the audacity to claim a covenant relationship with God, because we still say, in God we trust. And so I don't know, but stranger things have happened when God, by his permissive will, withdraws his hands of protection from his people. Let me tell you something. When God pulls his hand, when God leaves you out there exposed, you better understand that something is about to happen. And so it's at a moment of truth for those who have tested the limits of his patience. I believe folks just thought because the Lord didn't wipe us out. Yes, we've seen many tragedies. We've seen 9-1-1. We've seen what happened down there in Florida in that nightclub. We've seen how the young man went into a church and shot up a Bible study. We saw all that, but can I tell you, that happened at the hand of a man or men. But I'm talking about when God takes his hand off of us and he allows, you better get ready. You better get ready, because let me tell you something. I don't want to be turned over to a reprobate man. I don't want to be turned over to myself. Oh, yes, Judah. Judah had a covenant relationship. Judah was warned that the Lord himself would cut off the leader or the leaders who were responsible for his nation's fall. And so how long will God be silent in America? What will it be, or what will his punishment be? Judah had a covenant relationship with God, but a covenant relationship is only as solid as both sides are willing to agree. In other words, if you're going to be in a contract, the contract is only binding as long as all parties keep up their end of the agreement. Oh yes, covenant blessings require covenant faithfulness. In other words, if you want to continue to experience the blessing of God, you've got to continue to be faithful. Because the Lord don't reward filthiness, he rewards faithfulness. And so you've got to be faithful to God. As a nation, America has long ago broken its covenant with God. And the truth of the matter is, many no longer trust in God. It's evident. All you have to do is look around. You got a whole lot of folk. They may show up at church. They may show up at the mosque. They may show up at the whatever they go to. But a lot of folks still don't trust in the God that they serve. They think that because they got their health and they can go and make a dollar, that they're in control. But let me tell you something. Sooner or later, the one and only living true God is going to show himself. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to be at the end of God's chastisement. Half of our nation is willing to trust. Half. They just, let me, that you look at the numbers, we are really a nation divided. Half of us, one got the electoral vote, the other one got the popular vote. Half of our nation is willing to trust in a man whose only quoted scripture was an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's the only scripture he quoted throughout this. And so what is the punishment for our broken covenant relationship? We can just go back to what Romans say here in Romans chapter 1. Look at verse 28. This is the answer for us who will break a covenant relationship with God. This is the answer for a nation who will turn its heart away from God. Romans 1 and 28 says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. In other words, they forgot all about God. They forgot all about God's principle. God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. How many of you know that God will release a contemptible nation to his own reprobate and degenerate spirit? In other words, you want to be in control? You're in control now. You want to call the shots? You can call the shots now. But let me tell you something. I heard of a play that when I was coming up, there was a play, and I believe Patti LaBelle was the star. She said, your arms are too short to box with God. And I don't know about you. I'm not ready to get in there and tell. I want the Lord to continue to cover me, continue to lead me, and guide me. God will turn you over to a reprobate mind and a degenerate spirit. Those who find pleasure in the very thing that God abhors will carry themselves into their own destruction. Every night, we see it all the time. Where my parents at with grown kids, you done tried to raise them the right way. You done told them to do what is right, but now they want to be grown, and grown is gone, honey. Since you want to be grown, I'm going to turn you over to yourself. See how far you going to go on your own, and that's what God is going to do. And so as I get ready to close, I've come to the conclusion that yes, in this campaign, salacious aftermath, let me tell you, this was a tragedy. I was disheartened. I was sad. I was upset. But when we look at what happened to Judah, in the aftermath, Judah and America had so much in common. As a nation, we have turned our backs on God. I know you may not have done it. I may not have done it. But as a nation, the nation has turned its back on God. But I bring you some good news today. It's not too late. It's not too late. Why? Because the blood is still running warm in your veins. It's not too late. Why? Because you're still here. And I want you to know there is hope for America. And I couldn't let you leave out the sanctuary this morning without some hope. If the people of God turn from their wicked way, God says he will hear from heaven and will heal our land. And so whereas one candidate boasted scripture saying an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, I love the way Secretary Clinton closed her campaign out. She quoted a well-known verse of scripture found in Galatians, the 6th chapter, which says, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. The Old Testament prophet Isaiah put it this way. He said, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with